Have you ever pitched a goofy concept to your friends, maybe for a story or a product, only to later have the thought, wouldn't it be great if this thing actually got made somehow? What if that idea you casually joked about turned into a multi-million dollar franchise? Before 2014, few people would have bet that a game about a shovel-wielding protagonist would sell very many copies. Even fewer people would bet that such a protagonist would become such an instantly recognizable figure in video game culture. But Shovel Knight was an idea that just as easily could have fallen by the wayside. The cost to produce it was a heavy weight carried by too few developers with too little time to reach their goals. And in 2013, with the newly released Wii U, PS4, and Xbox One, the world of video games was rapidly evolving. The future was here. Would anyone even be interested in an 8-bit platformer anymore? The answer? Not only would it succeed, but it would do something nobody would have imagined, begin the 8-bit revival, and reinvigorate people's love for retro video games. This is the story of Shovel Knight. Founded in 1990, developer and publisher WayForward kept a steady stream of work, but didn't really take off until 2002, when they launched the critically acclaimed Shantae series. Among their employees were Ian Flood, David D'Angelo, Nick Wozniak, and Sean Velasco. The four were assigned to work on two projects together, A Boy and His Blob and Double Dragon Neon. The four quickly became friends and felt that they made an excellent team. Velasco even went to the higher-ups at WayForward to request that the small team get opportunities to work together on future projects. Unfortunately, the request was denied. The four friends began considering their options, and ultimately decided that the only way to continue working together would be to make their own game. They brought a fifth member on board, Aaron Pellin, and the small team began brainstorming ideas for their new game. They knew right off the bat that they'd want to make a 2D platformer, as they all grew up loving old-school Nintendo games. As an added bonus, an 8-bit game specifically would be a much more manageable task for such a small development team. Next, they looked for a hook, a gameplay mechanic that would be so intuitive that they could revolve everything else around it, like Mario's jumping or Mega Man's Buster Gun, the sort of move that would become ubiquitous with the game itself. The team really liked Link's downward sword attack from Zelda 2, where the hero holds the sword down while falling to hit enemies underneath. They decided to use that move as a creative launching point. We also wanted their main protagonist to feel very NES-like, to be designed so that he looks like he'd fit in with Mario or Sonic. That included giving him a generic yet iconic look, something that people could recognize from silhouette alone. Eventually, they settled on a knight and consciously designed their hero and the world around him to feel like he came straight out of a NES game. Someone suggested he carry a shovel instead of a sword, and the rest of the team thought this idea was hilarious. With their idea finalized, Velasco pitched the game to the higher-ups at WayForward, but was once again rejected. With no other path forward, Velasco and Ian Flood signed resignation letters, with the rest of the team to follow shortly after. The small Shovel Knight team was now 100% committed to making the game, a commitment not taken lightly by any of them, least of all Nick Wozniak. His wife was pregnant at the time, and they were expecting their first child very soon. It was absolutely the scariest time to quit a reliable job and begin working at a startup. Working out of a small apartment, the small team, now calling themselves Yacht Club, kept expenses to a minimum. They wanted to retain as many rights to their game as possible, so rather than go through a publisher, the small team decided to get the game crowdfunded instead.
Check it out. All right, look everybody, look. We're gonna launch the Kickstarter right now. Okay, so here it is. Wait, here, we're gonna go look at, look. There's David. He's right there. Okay.
And you.
All right. Oh, and me. Okay. Here it goes.
It's launched!
Oh my god. All right, we gotta get to work.
Kickstarter, at the time, was relatively new. They set a funding goal of $75,000, a modest number considering the time and effort that would be involved, but they figured it was better than asking for too much money and scaring away donors. But to the surprise and pleasure of the former WayForward employees, the Kickstarter was a huge success, and they reached their full $75,000 goal with 2 weeks of their funding deadline to spare. With enough money to hopefully last the duration of the project, Shovel Knight's development finally went into full gear. What followed would be a grueling 16 months, with long days and even longer nights, all dedicated towards making every detail of Shovel Knight, absolutely perfect. The story of Shovel Knight centers on the humble protagonist on a journey to rescue the damsel in distress from an evil wizard, and he'll need to best all sorts of knights and monsters to reach her. Like the simple narrative of Super Mario or Legend of Zelda, it always starts with saving the damsel. And while the Yacht Club team made efforts to be more socially progressive than the 80s games they drew inspiration from, they also couldn't just ignore that cornerstone of fantasy storytelling. The damsel in distress was essentially where we started, said programmer David D'Angelo. We really wanted people to stick to that model, because we thought, there's something about it that works. Obviously, looking at all the people criticizing games, the damsel in distress is so overused and so boring now that it's not really appealing anymore. So we wanted to find a way to make it work. If you look at something like Star Wars, it uses the damsel in distress model too, but it's wonderful and Leia looks way more badass than Luke. I guess it was trying to mold it into something that was appealing and modern, but still shows that the model is really effective. What would a good story be without memorable and unique characters? How well would Mega Man have taken off if his enemies were named Scissor Boy or Brash Lad? The makers of Shovel Knight knew their cast of characters needed to be special. Sometimes that meant having a funny, random idea of a character make it into the game for the sake of uniqueness. Take, for example, the Trouple King, a giant trout that is also part apple, an idea that Wozniak came up with one day when he saw a crate of apples that for some reason had a logo of a fish on it. Whether that's genius or just silly, one thing's for sure, you never forget a unique character.
A practitioner of the ancient code of Shovelry, Shovel Knight can do almost anything with his signature weapon, the Shovel Blade. His ingenuity and quick thinking have won him many battles, even though his stature is small. Always honest and helpful, Shovel Knight lives by the creed of Shovelry, slash mercilessly, and dig tirelessly.
When asked what makes Shovel Knight appealing, Nick Wozniak said, "He is a character who is very relatable, and there's nothing that puts you off from him. He has the horns and he's faceless, but he's kind of small in stature, and the underdog. I feel like he has a timeless appeal, similar to Mario and Sonic. His design is just easy to love, and it helps that the gameplay in the game is accessible to everyone."
As the yin to Shovel Knight's yang, the Black Knight calls nobody master. Clad in obsidian armor, he hounds Shovel Knight to the ends of the earth, spoiling for a battle.
According to the Yacht Club team, Black Knight was pretty much just created to move the plot along. Since Shovel Knight is so far removed from Shield Knight and the Enchantress for most of the game, they needed a character that could help bring their story threads closer together. We wanted to have a darker, more evil version of Shovel Knight to function as a rival, which led to the creation of the Black Knight. The archetype of the Black Knight comes from Arthurian legends, where they are usually portrayed as wandering knights that serve no master. As such, he was an interesting thematic foil for Shovel Knight, and he wasn't explicitly villainous. To draw further comparisons to Mega Man, he was the proto-man to Shovel Knight's Mega Man. Also facing off against Shovel Knight are the Order of No Quarter, who are less morally ambiguous. The Order is made up of King Knight, Plague Knight, Spectre Knight, Polar Knight, Treasure Knight, Tinker Knight, Mole Knight, and Propeller Knight. Let's start with the first villain drawn up by Yacht Club, King Knight.
King Knight isn't a king. He is a king-themed knight, but that doesn't stop him from making decrees. As the Lord Defender of Pridemoor Keep, he commands a formidable army of minions.
King Knight was the first boss we brought from concept to implementation. He helped solidify the game's humor and overall tone. He's a king, but he's also a knight? Then what even is a knight? When asked who their favorite character in the game was, the majority of the team chose King Knight.
Even his comrades give Plague Knight a wide berth, because he spreads more than just the common cold. With an array of mysterious and magical bottles at his side, Plague Knight could be considered the black sheep of the Order of No Quarter.
Plague Knight was originally an explosives-themed boss called Dynamite, think Dynamite, but when we brought the character into a medieval setting and established the Plague Doctor motif, we decided Plague Knight was a lot easier to say than Dynamite.
In life, Spectre Knight was a cruel and cunning warrior. And although his blood is now icy cold, he is no less formidable as a phantasm.
Coming from the perspective of an animator, said Nick Wozniak, I have to say Spectre Knight is my favorite. He's all flowing cloth and too cool for school attitude, and I had a lot of fun getting that into the character's movement.
Of all the monsters roaming Shovel Knight's world, none are as dangerous as the Enchantress. Cold, brilliant, and pulsing with vile power, the Enchantress is a preternatural force.
The Enchantress was based on Maleficent from Disney's Sleeping Beauty. The amulet on her forehead was devised as a target to hit, as it felt wrong for Shovel Knight to directly harm someone he cares about. The Enchantress went through many revisions, as we tried to capture the right mix of danger, aloofness, and sex appeal. Originally, she had a low-cut neckline and exposed back, but it didn't feel quite right.
For years, Shield Knight and Shovel Knight were inseparable partners in adventuring. With their expert use of unconventional weapons, they worked as one. Now, Shield Knight's fate is unknown, but Shovel Knight's goal is clear. He must journey to find Shield Knight, his lost beloved.
The team admitted that not much was planned around Shield Knight's character initially. She was just a MacGuffin, a literary device used to advance the plot, so for a while, she was just called Princess MacGuffin. And later, her stand-in name was simply Beloved. In fact, Shield Knight's role in the story was originally going to be a lot sadder. According to Sean Velasco, it was supposed to be that Shovel Knight gets all the way to the end of the game, kills the Enchantress, and it turns out it's Shield Knight. So you have to bury your wife with, like, a shovel. It was like, that's the story, how can we make that happen? Obviously it's changed a lot from that, but the idea of making something that was a little bit heartwarming, but a little bit sad, and a little bit melancholy sometimes, that was kind of in our brains from the beginning. In fact, Shield Knight's sad fate was kept in the story until just a few months before the game came out. It was scrapped in favor of a happier ending, as the team knew that ending didn't really suit the tone of the game, and as Velasco went on to say, everyone would have hated it. While the final version wasn't so grim, the melancholy surrounding Shield Knight's character could definitely be felt in the game. Between levels, Shovel Knight dreams of his love falling from the sky, and you have to catch her. The inclusion of this minigame helps show Shovel Knight's love for his princess without needing to say anything out loud. It's sweet and a bit sad, especially early in the game when you know very little about whether or not she's safe. As far as design goes, Shield Knight was intentionally created to share similar armor to Shovel Knight, to show they're equals. Their partner is going on adventures together, and while she was originally created as a damsel in distress, Yacht Club wanted her to stand on her own as a strong character. They even acknowledged making a conscious effort to not sexualize characters in the game, the exception being Propeller Knight, which various members of the team have repeatedly said is very sexy. On the topic of gender inclusivity, Yacht Club acknowledged making, quote, missteps in previous works. In a blog post, the team lamented about how their 80s-inspired project came from a time without a lot of female representation. To illustrate the point, they posted a picture of the bosses from the original Mega Man series, with the caption, "That's a lot of man." So after reaching an additional tier on Kickstarter, Yacht Club added a gender swap mode to the game, which allows players to swap the gender of the main characters, both in appearance and in how they're dressed. This modification wouldn't change anything about the gameplay, but it would, they hoped, introduce Shovel Knight to a more diverse audience. Some characters were easier to remodel than others. Shield Knight, for instance, didn't require many modifications. King Knight, however, was changed to Queen Knight, and thus a whole new aesthetic was necessary. Same with the Enchantress, changed to the Enchanter, etc. The remainder of the Order of No Quarter, along with a dozen or so minor characters, brought a great deal of charm to the game. Even the villagers, who are sometimes human and sometimes horse people, somehow feels right within the Shovel Knight world. With the storyline and characters all planned out, Yacht Club would next need to design and program the game itself. It's simple and understandable while being complex, intriguing, engaging, and fun like the NES games that inspired it. Every component is built like this, from its simple but effective story to its gameplay and aesthetics. David D'Angelo. The NES had a profound impact on the Yacht Club team. Their goal was to make a game that felt like it belonged in that era. The influence of certain games in particular are hard to ignore. The Legend of Zelda 2 was a deep well of inspiration for Shovel Knight, besides just Link's downward thrust move. In Zelda 2, you could explore different towns and have limited interactions with NPCs. The team at Yacht Club wanted to expand on that idea, with NPCs that were weird, interesting, and far from generic. Not to mention a town itself that had more secrets and areas to discover. The storybook-style intro was inspired by The Legend of Zelda: The Minish Cap. Shovel Knight's ability to bounce on a shovel like a pogo stick was lifted from DuckTales on the NES, based on the popular 90s cartoon. DuckTales would later get a remaster in 2013 by, coincidentally, WayForward. The world map that the players used to go from level to level was based on a similar concept from Mario Bros. 3, including the occasional run-in with unique enemies. One of the most iconic visuals in Shovel Knight is the campfire sequences, where the hero has a tranquil moment at the campfire to rest before the next battle. The notoriously difficult Dark Souls featured a similar mechanic, where campfires acted as checkpoints. And the idea of a protagonist facing off against 8 bosses is, of course, based on Mega Man. Yacht Club acknowledged as much, stating that the boss gauntlet formula is one of the cornerstones of Shovel Knight's gameplay. In fact, it's been said that Shovel Knight is the true successor to Mega Man. Other games, like the 2016 platformer Mighty No. 9, tried to be a spiritual successor to the Blue Bomber, but unfortunately, Mighty No. 9's commercial failure was largely due to its slavish devotion to mirroring its source material. That meant not making improvements to what made Mega Man special, like its core gameplay, and not discarding elements that were always bad, like its voice acting.
Why you not burn? You must recover all the energy immediately, Mega Man.
In the end, Yacht Club knew that it wasn't enough for Shovel Knight to be just an homage to NES games. It had to be an improvement of them. One immediately noticeable modern upgrade is that the game is presented in widescreen, as opposed to the NES era's 4x3 aspect ratio. Arguably, the 4x3 format was always just a technical limitation, so like the unforgiving Game Overs, this was also removed for the player's benefit. Another way Shovel Knight broke free from the binds of the NES is the inclusion of parallax scrolling. When several layers move at different speeds, it helps 2D games appear more 3D by creating the illusion of depth. The Super Nintendo was able to handle multiple background layers, but its predecessor, the NES, simply couldn't. So while adding parallax scrolling was technically breaking the format, Yacht Club decided that giving the player better visuals was ultimately more important. The NES was only able to output 54 different colors, which was a pretty limited palette. It did, however, create a distinct visual style, and Yacht Club did their best to stay within that color limit. Several characters were redesigned, limiting their design to 4 or 5 colors, to keep that NES look, and to make animating easier for the small Yacht Club team. They did make a few exceptions, notably making Polar Knight's sheepskin beige, a color that's not present anywhere else in the game. Another NES limitation? Large sprites. The sprite hardware on the NES was not optimal for drawing very large, moving objects due to the limitations it imposed, explained Wozniak. To get around this limitation, clever developers displayed big art as animated background tile layers. That's the reason why, whenever you fight a large enemy on the NES, they're usually on a black screen with no background art. Boss is the background. We thought that the black background with the huge boss always gave NES games a distinctive and epic feel, where the focus was just on you and your enemy, so we decided it was important to keep. However, lacking sprite limitations, we didn't need to mess with background layers or any workarounds to make a large sprite possible. We simply used our animated sprite code, were careful with the designs, and made sure the sprite was on a black or very dark background. Besides improving core mechanics, Shovel Knight also took gameplay elements from the past and added its own unique spin. The relics are a great example, said Nick Wozniak. The reason we don't have a new weapon at the end of each stage in Shovel Knight is because in Mega Man, you get a weapon and you don't use it because you don't know what it does or when it's useful. It may not even be useful in the next stage at all, because you chose the next stage. So we made the decision to put the relics in the stages themselves to emphasize them, and tried to make it so that when you got a new relic, you could use it and see its effects immediately. The harsh difficulty of older NES games is also curbed majorly in Shovel Knight. Specifically, there are no game overs. If you die, you're sent back to the last checkpoint, and you lose some of your hard-earned loot as well. This incentivizes players to do better without the overbearing penalties of older games. In fact, Shovel Knight could break the save points to get some more money, at the expense of losing the save point. This risk-reward system was specifically included to provide balance between veteran players and newcomers. Yacht Club made an emphasis to value the player's time with their creative decisions. They made sure that all storyline cutscenes were skippable, and all the dialogue was short and to the point. Every interaction between Shovel Knight and another character was relegated to 4 or 5 lines at maximum. This became a challenge in and of itself for the development team, needing to make sure that every line of text conveyed as much information as possible about the plot and fleshed out the character speaking as much as possible. This is evident, especially in the humor of the game. Take this interaction between Shovel Knight and Grandma Swamp. Its charm comes from just how precise it's able to tell a joke while establishing the perspectives of two different characters with just a few lines of text. Very often, with good writing, less is more. Even visual cues were added to get the player engaged more quickly, such as adding the looming Tower of Fate in the background of the first level. This tells the player, instantly, that reaching this tower is their ultimate goal. Shovel Knight was designed to feel like it could have existed in the 8-bit era, rather than just feeling like an homage to 8-bit gaming. Think the Wonder Years rather than Stranger Things. We were thinking very hard on how to not make it nostalgia bait, explains D'Angelo. It was very important to us that we didn't have any references in the game. The classic example is in a lot of retro games, as a joke, you'll see, "It's too dangerous to go alone, take this." So we want to stay away from stuff like that. We wanted to make it so that Shovel Knight could live on its own, and you could pick up Shovel Knight and have never played a video game before and enjoy it. Nothing in there was dependent on anything else. Composing Shovel Knight's soundtrack was an unlikely duo, Manami Matsume and Jake Kaufman. Matsume had composed her fair share of soundtracks for video games in the late 80s and early 90s, and most notably creating the score for Mega Man and Mega Man 2. Considering how much Shovel Knight was inspired by the original Mega Man, it was an excellent choice and a great get for Yacht Club Games. Matsume had just that year joined the newly formed Brave Wave record label. Several accomplished composers are signed on to their label, including David Wise, the man who made the iconic Donkey Kong Country soundtrack, and Yoko Shimomura, most famous for Kingdom Hearts' critically acclaimed score. Brave Wave's focus is to bring together composers of the chiptune pre-internet era, and also to bridge the gap between Japanese and Western game composers. It was through Brave Wave that Yacht Club was able to meet and hire Matsume. Jake Kaufman also had an impressive resume, having composed scores for dozens of video games previously. Working at WayForward, he made the score for the first two Shantae games, and while he didn't join Yacht Club in their exodus from WayForward, he did manage to work hard on Shovel Knight's soundtrack while working for both companies. Together, Kaufman and Matsume came up with a delightful chiptune soundtrack that genuinely feels like it came right out of an NES cartridge. In fact, Kaufman, to ensure authenticity, converted his sound files into a format that the NES or Famicom could actually play. Attending that year's SuperCon, a comic book convention in Florida, Kaufman showed off his soundtrack. He had burned the sound files onto a real Famicom cart and was playing the music through an actual Famicom. For his part, Jake Kaufman was unofficially the sixth member of the Yacht Club family. It was several months into their journey, and the Yacht Club team was making great progress building their first game. Next, they would need to show off what they had made so far to the world. Could their idea of a shovel-wielding knight really go the distance? They would soon find out. Yacht Club Games planned to make their premiere on the world stage at PAX East, an annual gaming conference, in 2013. They were desperately behind schedule, and not even sure if they'd have a functioning demo to show off at the event. "If we didn't have anything," said Sean Velasco, "we were going to pull beanbag chairs out and play Mario 64, with a sign that said, Shovel Knight, coming soon." Fortunately, Sean and the rest of his small team wrapped up the demo, King Knight stage, without a moment to spare. They set up a small, humble booth with their demo ready to play. They fared well, drumming up some hype for their flagship title. Popular gaming website Destructoid even called their demo a must-play. To get some positive exposure for their game, Yacht Club sent an early build of Shovel Knight to popular gaming journalists and influencers like Game Grumps and Rooster Teeth, so they could play the game in one of their videos. "We made a big effort to try and get in touch with YouTubers and try to show them why the game was appealing and why it would be good for them to play," said David D'Angelo. "Other than the money we spent to go to conventions, we didn't spend any money on marketing or ads or anything like that. What we tried to do was get the game into people's hands, people that would be excited about it and would promote it in a way that made sense for us. I think YouTube was the strongest thing we could do there." Nintendo itself was very helpful with the process, according to Yacht Club. As a company, they were very supportive of indie developers, and did a good job prepping them for everything they'd need before launching on their consoles. In February of 2014, Nintendo even offered a slot on its popular Nintendo Direct stream to Velasco and Wozniak so they could promote their upcoming title. Their appearance on Nintendo Direct ended up being huge for them, leading to a tremendous spike in funding and interest in the game. In Kickstarter, you could set stretch goals, which are additional goals past your original ask. Shovel Knight reached its funding goal with 2 weeks to spare, to the relief of the small creative team. So, they decided to up the ante by offering a new game plus mode for an additional $25,000 and a four-player battle mode for an additional $100,000. Yacht Club offered additional mystery modes if funding went past $200,000, not really expecting that to happen. To their surprise, the additional money was given, and they were thrilled that so many people believed in their vision for their 8-bit platformer. But while their crowdfunding donations were far more than they had expected to receive, it was still not nearly enough to actually produce the game. In a blog post, Yacht Club Games broke down their finances very transparently. Assuming each of the six members of the team received a salary of $10,000 a month, and they estimated the base game and stretch goals would take 2 years to make, that would mean that the cost to produce the game would be over $1.44 million. $10,000 a month per employee is not uncommon in the developer industry, and while it may sound lucrative, the take-home pay is always far less, as the $10,000 is before taxes, healthcare, work expenses, etc. However, Shovel Knight didn't have a $1.44 million budget. It had a little over $300,000. That meant that realistically, each member of the team would be lucky if they got paid $2,000 a month. At this point, you have to be thinking, $30,000 minus taxes for 1 year salary, a grueling workplace, think 12 to 18 hours a day, 7 days a week, no stability whatsoever, why bother? The blog post read. An NES game that's not gonna sell? The 80s are over, man. Get with the times. The cool kids are all into AAA explosive action sequences. You'll never make it. By March of 2014, Shovel Knight's budget had been completely spent, even with the additional stretch goal money. The small Yacht Club team decided to cut all expenses down to absolute essentials, like internet and electricity. The team members started to put their own money into the game and dug deep into savings to cover basic necessities. It was a difficult period, where some of us were awkwardly standing in front of cashiers, having our credit cards declined, drawing from any possible savings, and borrowing money from our friends and family. They were in a difficult position, where they needed the base game of Shovel Knight to be successful, or they wouldn't be able to make the bonus content promised to Kickstarter donors. The pressure to succeed was palpable. When Shovel Knight finally made its grand debut in June of 2014, success absolutely blew away the hardworking team of six who had put their blood, sweat, and tears into this project. On its first week of release, it was the number one selling game on Nintendo's 3DS eStore, and number two on the Wii U eStore, only being topped by the long-established Mario Kart 8. Shovel Knight, in all its old-school glory, is arguably the best game released so far in 2014. IGN. A hallmark of excellence, Destructoid. Shovel Knight is the kind of game people write love letters about. Polygon. Looking back on the previous year's endeavors, Sean Velasco said that none of it would have worked if the team didn't already have the advantage of knowing each other and working well together. Having a team that you don't know, that seems impossible. If you've never done a game before, doing a game and a Kickstarter for the first time, that just seems like a formula for disaster. Sean Velasco had always dreamt of Shovel Knight making it into Super Smash Bros. After Shovel Knight was introduced to the world, he quickly became a video game icon. Nintendo recognized the rising star's popularity, and so it wasn't long before they decided to add him to their flagship brawler as an assist trophy. But that was more than enough to thrill the Yacht Club team. Shovel Knight made history for not only being the first independent publisher to make it into Smash, but the first to have an amiibo as well. First launched in 2014, amiibos are Nintendo figurines that contain data which can be loaded by the built-in NFC reader found on the Wii U, 3DS, and Nintendo Switch. These collectible figurines often contain unlockables from within their respective games. In Shovel Knight, unlockables ranged from new costumes, to new moves, to additional challenge levels. Inspired by Soul Calibur 2's console-specific cameos, Yacht Club sought to replicate that idea in Shovel Knight. In the PlayStation ports of the game, Kratos, from the God of War series, comes to challenge Shovel Knight. In the Xbox release of the game, the Battletoads take center stage. This was a big get for Yacht Club. According to Velasco, all he had to do to secure Kratos and Battletoads cameos was simply ask. Sony and Microsoft, big fans of Shovel Knight, were happy to lend their characters. For completely unfathomable reasons, Shovel Knight even got a sponsorship with Arby's. For a limited time in 2021, each Arby's kids meal came with one of seven token launcher toys, with the tokens themselves having a code which would unlock cheat code DLC within the game. Shovel Knight's DLC token would change the text of the game, replacing the knight's names with the word meat. Shield Knight's DLC token replaces her character in the dream sequence with that of a fallen sandwich. And the Black Knight's DLC token adds a Navi-style fairy that follows your character around through the game. The catch, if you haven't guessed, is that the fairy is a sandwich. Interestingly, during the promotion, Plague Knight was renamed Dr. Knight, with the quotation marks being kept in. A tongue-in-cheek joke about their unfortunate timing, them having to release a kid's toy with the name Plague Knight a year into the COVID-19 epidemic. By the time Shovel Knight had premiered at PAX East, the Kickstarter fund had exceeded all their stretch goals, reaching $311,000. Yacht Club was now on the hook for all the extras and bonuses they had promised their backers. With the base game finally shipping in June of 2014, it was time for the Shovel Knight team to switch gears towards fulfilling their stretch goal promises. The first being, create a new game mode with three playable villains. The three chosen were Plague Knight, Spectre Knight, and King Knight. Yacht Club decided to start their new chapter of Shovel Knight with Plague of Shadows. On Kickstarter, the team had just promised playable villains, nothing more. And considering that the crowdfunding money had already been spent by that point, Yacht Club very understandably could have just squeezed out something passable to please the fans. However, going above and beyond was what made Shovel Knight so successful, so why give any less for the bonus chapters? Initially, it was like Richter mode on Symphony of the Night, explained Sean Velasco. Like, oh yeah, it'll just be a new character and we'll redo the animations. The cutscenes will be the same and it won't be anything new. But then we were like, well, maybe it could be a little bit different. Because we started to think about it, well, it'd be weird if Plague Knight had to run around in the village but people just said the exact same thing to him, right? Like, maybe he doesn't go to the village. And it just grew up from that. We wanted him to explode, jump through the air, and maybe he's an eight-way directional guy. Maybe he bounces off the walls, Nick Wozniak gushed. We just had no idea, and so when you start talking about a game, you get excited, and you feel that fervor again, like, oh, this could be fun. Their enthusiasm was evident in the final product. The original concept of a simple character swamp had evolved into more of a new game plus, with new skills to use, enemies to fight, and old levels being modified to accommodate Plague Knight's unique moves. Plague of Shadows released the following year as a free DLC for players who had already bought the original game. Incidentally, to avoid confusion with these new DLC releases, the base game Shovel Knight was renamed Shovel of Hope, likely a nod to the original Star Wars being renamed Episode 4 A New Hope. By the time Plague of Shadows was released, the Yacht Club team was at their breaking point. For over a year, they were pushing themselves to make their deadline with Shovel of Hope, and then immediately were thrust into this new tight deadline for Plague of Shadows. The team had worked overtime for so long, and they were massively burnt out. To make matters worse, they still had two more boss modes to create, and additional stretch goals to fulfill. Any ideas the team dreamt of for new projects would have to be shelved for quite a while. For the time being, they were a company that made Shovel Knight games. Things got a lot better for the team once royalty checks from Shovel of Hope began to arrive in the mail. They were finally getting to enjoy the fruits of their labor. Their debts were gone, and they finally had enough financial comfort to take a breath. The next two installments, Spectre of Torment and King of Cards, were made simultaneously, a task made easier by the six additional developers added to the team since Shovel of Hope launched. Yacht Club was growing, but even still, they knew they had to rein it in a bit, as their first DLC had taken far longer than expected. Spectre of Torment was released in March of 2017, and was well received by fans and critics. Yacht Club intended to copy the formula for their second DLC and use it for King Knight's King of Cards installment. But that didn't pan out. Spectre Knight's moves were too different. The levels they made for him were too specific for that character. It just wouldn't have worked for King Knight. So, after promising themselves that they wouldn't become victim to their own ambition again, the team of 12 went back to the drawing board, intent on making a completely new experience for their third DLC. King Knight's Tale was the most unique of the three, including an elaborate card game called Joustus, which was based on Final Fantasy VIII's Triple Triad. The game was able to be made on less of a time crunch compared to the previous entries. Shovel Knight had finally become lucrative to Yacht Club Games, with over 2 million copies of the base game sold by April of 2018. That meant that the small team had enough capital to produce King of Cards stress-free. A whole 2.5 years of development went into their final DLC, twice the time it took to make the original Shovel Knight. It's a brand new game, really, John Velasco said. It has art and elements and story stuff from the other games, but it all really ties together. The final DLC, Showdown, is a multiplayer, Smash Brothers inspired fighting game starring the main characters of Shovel Knight. Like the previous entries, Showdown went above and beyond what was initially promised. It featured 20 playable fighters, with each one having their own storyline and moveset. The final DLC was released on most platforms the previous installments were on, save the Nintendo 3DS. It had been so long since Shovel Knight's launch that 3DS games weren't even being made anymore. Shovel Knight's popularity has surpassed what Yacht Club games ever could have hoped for. Besides making it big in Smash Brothers, the Blue Knight has also made cameos in over 30 games, including Yooka-Laylee, Brawlhalla, and so many more. Yacht Club's first collaboration with another game developer took the form of a dungeon crawler puzzle game titled Pocket Dungeon. Originally called Puzzle Knights, small developer Vine caught the attention of Yacht Club Games, who saw the potential to rework this game into a Shovel Knight property. Released in December of 2021, Pocket Dungeon was well received by critics. IGN called it a wonderful spin-off that combines block-falling puzzles and roguelike mechanics in remarkable clever ways, resulting in yet another excellent entry in the Shovel Knight series. In September of 2022, Yacht Club released Shovel Knight Dig, a spin-off game in collaboration with game developer Nitron. In this iteration, players would adventure down vertical stages, not unlike the arcade classic Dig Dug. "We were interested in making a new Shovel Knight game, but we wanted to work with a different studio to create it," explained Celia Schilling, Yacht Club marketing manager. "Our first choice was Nitron. We reached out to them, and they were ecstatic because they're a fan of our games, and we're a fan of them. We did a high five, did some contract stuff, and got started on the game." Dig was released shortly before the writing of this video, but so far, the reviews are favorable. From their humble origins as a ragtag group of like-minded developers at WayForward, to their well-deserved success as a growing indie publisher, the Yacht Club team had accomplished quite a lot. And none of it would have happened if not for the tireless efforts of Sean Velasco, Nick Wozniak, and the rest, giving it their all and believing strongly in their shovel-wielding creation. And as for the future, they still have grand designs for their breakout star. "We would love to make a Shovel Knight 64, or a Shovel Knight Hoops," said Ian Flood. "A Shovel Knight basketball game may seem like a stretch, but considering he already has his own tabletop board game, anything is possible." Sean Velasco showed some interest in the Shovel Knight animated series on Netflix. He noted the success of Castlevania and thought it wasn't too far off of the concept. Sean also joked about wanting a Shovel Knight cereal with gems and little shovel marshmallows. Celia Schilling said, "We plan on making Shovel Knight games forever and ever. As for what our plan is, it's just whatever sounds cool and what sounds fun to make." The nostalgia for a bygone era, particularly the heyday of the NES, make up the heart and soul of this game. Shovel Knight clearly has reverence for the past, and doesn't try to hide the fact that it wouldn't exist if not for its 8-bit ancestors. Inspiration aside, I think it's fair to say this game could stand firmly on its own. It could be enjoyed even by people who didn't get to experience those long-lost days. Sometimes even something derivative can earn its seat at the table and become iconic in its own right. All we ever dreamed of is, one day somebody will cosplay as us. We want people to be invested in the stuff we make. We are so invested in it, we ate and breathed it for the 16 months it took to make it, and we're still making it, we're still adding updates. So for people to be just as excited about it, and just as invested in it as us, is really wonderful, heartwarming, and encouraging. David D'Angelo. It has been so hard at times, and so dark at times, but overall, it's just been, what an incredible ride. I'm so lucky that I got to do this. Sean Velasco.
Bye.